I hope you all enjoyed lunch. We're going to go ahead and get started on our next speaker of the day, Ian Haworth. He is originally from the United Kingdom. Haworth came to the United States to work in Silicon Valley at Facebook in the fact-checking and misinformation team. After 4 years in Silicon Valley, he left to pursue a career in political commentary, where he was the host of Daily Wire's short, The Morning Wire. Haworth has been published in Town Hall, The Washington Examiner, The Federalist, and many more. Haworth frequently speaks at YAF, and he is here today to talk about the myths of gun control and why we need to protect our constitutional rights. Everyone, please give a warm welcome to Ian Haworth.
So I make a joke about the steps every single time I speak with YAF, and I almost just like collapsed over there, so I'm glad it worked out. Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be with you in beautiful Santa Barbara. I do feel places like this make California look better than it is. I've been here since last night. I haven't had to dodge any needles, any poop, so it's a miracle. Also, can we get a round of applause for YAF getting over 1 billion views on YouTube? It's pretty awesome. Pretty cool. And I'm responsible for like 10 of them, so you're welcome, I guess. So I'm here today to talk about gun control. Well, I'm really here to talk about all the lies you've been told about gun control, because you've been told a lot of lies. Guns really are the left's favorite boogeyman. They roll out gun control propaganda every single time they can, even when it's out of nowhere. So Joe Biden, or more likely the poor intern who's been given the job of tweeting for Joe Biden, randomly announces that we should ban assault weapons or specific types of braces or accessories because they make bullets fly faster or something. No comments on Hunter Biden illegally having a gun, of course. Unfortunately for people who care about reality, almost everything you're told about gun control by the left is just not true. But before we dig into these lies, I think it's really important to address the facts over feelings issue that comes up all the time when it comes to guns. So as conservatives, we love to focus on facts because facts are good. Turns out the truth is pretty awesome. And a lot of the time, we see our opponents being obsessed with just feelings. And a lot of the time, they are obsessed with feelings. Endless arguments that appeal to emotion, but are not based on really anything else. Democrats are the worst at this, like Jamal Bowman screaming in Thomas Massie's face, or the people who showed up at the Tennessee State House with children's caskets. No actual data, just emotion. And all of this plays into a struggle between facts and feelings, and the conservative response is usually facts over feelings. Now, facts should matter more than feelings, but I think when it comes to gun rights and gun control, conservatives sometimes go too far. All too often, we just ignore the feelings. And that is hurting the pro-gun movement, because it is an emotional topic, really, whether you like it or not. When we're talking about a lot of politicians, feelings and emotions are just fake. But a lot of others are truly passionate about this topic for good and understandable reasons. They might be wrong, or their solutions might be completely ineffective, but that doesn't mean that their intentions aren't good. Ignoring their feelings isn't a great way to reach those people. So I think it'll help all of us if we just hit the reset button if we actually want to change these people's minds. We should continue to care about facts, but at least acknowledge the feelings. Because the truth is, we all agree that gun violence is horrific, whether individual firearm homicides or mass shootings. But we're never meeting on that shared platform. Yes, a lot of this is down to propaganda that just paints us as uncaring, but it's a label we sometimes unintentionally help with. When innocent people are murdered, we do care. We are upset. We are angry. But we actually want to solve problems rather than just sell empty promises. Just because people want to do something in the aftermath of really any tragedy, it still matters what that something is. Doing anything is not the same as doing something effective. It's all about finding a balance. So we can acknowledge people's feelings, agree on the fact that most of us have the same goal, and then focus on rational solutions. But there are so many lies being told about gun control that's really stopping this from happening. These fundamental problems are standing in the way of any actual progress in the fight against violence. And I want to talk about just a few of them. So the first lie is that they don't want to take your guns. Make no mistake, they want to take your guns. When it comes to gun violence, and all types, not just mass shootings, The goal should be to find ways to reduce the risk of violence being committed with a firearm. But for a lot of the gun control side, that's not the goal. The goal is to destroy your right to own firearms in the first place. They know they can't do it overnight, so like everything on the left, they do it piece by piece with actions and propaganda. One example, they'll say they don't want to ban guns, just semi-automatic guns, which any gun owner will tell you is basically all guns. With the same goal, they use the complicated issue of gun violence as an excuse to destroy gun rights, under the false banner of just doing something, and by labeling law-abiding gun owners as part of the problem, even though they weren't the ones who pulled the trigger. We don't do this for any other crime. Do we blame all knife owners for stabbings? Do we blame all drivers for hit and runs? Do we blame all MMA fighters for random assaults on the street? I guess it depends on the fighter, but almost always no. But that's what they do with gun owners every single day. They say that we must do something, but their something is what they wanted to do all along, to get rid of guns. And if you disagree, it's not because you're disagreeing with the solution. You're disagreeing with the problem. If you're not on board, you're also to blame. It's gross, immoral, and most importantly, wrong. They also do this with everything else. If you oppose giving billions of dollars to Ukraine with no questions asked, it's because you love Putin. If you oppose abortion, it's because you want women to be raped and to die. If you don't think we should ban gas cars, you want Greta Thunberg to drown. And what's the result? Gun owners don't want to engage because they're sick and tired of being labeled as murderers. And I do get why. All this does is create a cycle where nothing changes. This is made even worse by the political filter that's applied in the aftermath of every single shooting. This filter is applied by both sides and involves who the shooter is, who was shot, and if necessary, what they were shot with. So for example, for the left, when the shooter is a white male, the problem is always racism and guns. When the shooter isn't a white male, then depending on the victim, the gun is the problem. Racism suddenly disappears. And if the shooter is black and the victim is black, you probably won't even hear about it. So more on that a little bit later. And if inconvenient details come out along the way, they're either ignored or the story also just goes away. And again, this swings both ways. When conservatives obsessed over the fact that the Nashville school shooter was transgender, was there really any difference to the identity politics obsession of the left? Suddenly, all people care about is the identity characteristics of the shooter, never the victims. All life is valuable, not just life that helps promote a narrative. We can't solve this problem unless we treat every life as equally valuable. Unfortunately, in our current political climate, that's really not the case. Another lie is that gun control people are always right, and we don't even need this debate. One of the biggest problems in the aftermath of a publicized shooting is a rush to judgment, looking to push a narrative, assuming we know the answer before we have any actual information. News breaks and we immediately hear things like, well, if we'd only had common sense gun laws, none of this would have happened. No one cares about motive or institutional failures or whether the guns were purchased legally. All they care about is pushing the gotcha response and, again, subtly blaming anyone who disagrees with their policy for the shooting itself. No one cares about what actually happened, why it happened, what mistakes happened along the way. If the label of racism can be applied, it is, regardless of whether racism is a factor, and the same is true for really all other labels. And all of this, again, has one goal, blame pro-gun people for gun violence. No one wants to talk about the fact that the vast majority of violence occurs in areas run by Democrats for decades. No one wants to talk about the fact that violence explodes in areas really drained of law enforcement. No one wants to talk about the media's role in all of this. The issue with the media could be solved overnight if we wanted to. In the immediate aftermath of certain mass shooting events, the identity of the shooter spreads like wildfire, and the mainstream media is fanning the flames. Headlines spread clickbait, attracting readers with really a nasty form of live true crime, asking who is the shooter, and offering the latest on what we know. Images of the shooter are all over all of our screens, and media outlets fight to uncover even the smallest details about the latest overnight sensation. This happens pretty much every single time. And it's giving these evil murderers exactly what they want. What? Really, why? Well, because these shooters are often looking for immediate notoriety, and the media is just giving it to them. Some researchers have warned about a contagion theory, with mass media and social media coverage found to be a significant driving factor.
And when we consider that shooters themselves have openly talked about their soon-to-be infamy, why is the media giving these people exactly what they want? I guess clicks are more important. But there's another part of this that we haven't talked about yet. How do we actually start solving the problem? Well, first, it's not a problem we will ever truly solve, because evil will always exist. No politician ever wants to tell you that. All we can do is guard against it as well as we can. And to do this, we first need to understand the problem. So let's talk about it, because you're also being lied to about the problem. And to talk about the problem honestly, this is where facts come in again. There are too many data points just to list, but I want to give you just a few that highlight how misguided the gun control narrative actually is. First off, you'll usually hear a raw number of gun deaths per year, but you won't be told that the majority of those are suicides. And while every death is tragic, and there's so much more we can do to address the mental health epidemic going on in our country, suicide and homicide are not the same thing. So let's talk about homicide rather than just death. This is where the left is obsessed, and I mean obsessed, with banning so-called assault weapons. Most of them can't define what an assault weapon is, beyond that it is black and looks scary and has bigger and faster bullets than handguns. But in the same way that mass shootings in schools are publicized, but mass shootings in inner cities are not, you are being lied to about the firearms themselves. For people not paying attention, given the amount of time spent going after AR-15s and other big, scary guns, surely they're the biggest, really, piece of the problem. That's just wrong. In the United States, the majority of firearm homicides, around 60%, are committed with handguns. Under 3% of firearm homicides are committed with rifles. In fact, in 2019, more murders were committed with blunt objects, knives, fists, and feet than rifles. And what about the people who are the most likely victims of firearm homicide? They're disproportionately male, disproportionately young, and disproportionately black. First, your risk skyrockets if you're a young male. Across all races and age groups, men are 5 times more likely to be shot and killed than women. For younger ages, it gets even more drastic. Between 15 and 19, men are almost 7 times more likely to be shot and killed. And that rate increases for 20 to 24-year-olds, and again for 25 to 29-year-olds. Over half of all firearm death victims are males between the ages of 15 and 34. And when we break it down by race, it gets even more shocking. The fact is that black people are far more likely to be the victim of gun violence than any other racial group. In 2020, black people were murdered with firearms at 3 times the rate of any other group. In 2019, almost 60% of all firearm deaths were black people, almost all of them male. More than half of all firearm death victims are black males, even though they're just over 6% of the population. So let me say that again. More than half of all victims of gun homicides are black males, and they only make up 6% of the population. So when we hear about gun violence, why don't we hear about handguns? When we hear about gun violence, why don't we only talk about mass shootings when they make up a tiny proportion of firearm deaths? Why don't we hear about the young black men who are being killed at wildly disproportionate rates? Well, because people are refusing to acknowledge the full problem. Instead, they cherry-pick real parts of the problem and present it as the entire problem. And the reason for that is simple. This is just all political. It's all about distracting people from the entire problem, and for the left with the help of the media. Again, every instance of gun violence is tragic. But if all life is precious and valuable, which it is, then this includes the thousands of black people who are murdered every year while no one seems to care, unless the shooter is white. At every level of the debate, when we start looking at actual data, the gun control narrative just falls apart. Here's another example. The idea that there's a direct link with gun ownership and gun violence, and that more guns equals more gun violence. So in other words, if we reduce the number of guns, we'll reduce the number of gun deaths. That's simply not true. It is true that the US has the highest level of civilian gun ownership. We're talking about more than one gun per person. But if more guns means more deaths, then why does the US have a lower rate of deaths for every gun owned per 100,000 people than Switzerland? And the same as one of Bernie Sanders' favorite countries, Finland. What about the fact that as gun ownership has increased over time, the rate of firearm homicides has decreased? People just assume there's an association between the number of guns and the rate of gun violence. The data doesn't back it up. In fact, the data doesn't really back up any of their proposed solutions. To put it bluntly, their ideas do not work. What about gun bans? You always hear Australia and the UK as success stories. But the people pushing these stories either don't understand math or haven't bothered to look at the data at all. In Australia, they tried to enforce a mandatory gun buyback program after a mass shooting in 1996. Based on one Harvard review, their firearm homicide rate dropped by about 42% in 7 years after the law passed, and the firearm suicide rate fell by about 57%. But we also don't know if the drop was caused by the gun buyback or other legal changes, or even natural changes, given that gun deaths were already declining. Also, the rate of gun violence, and especially mass shootings, was already so low in Australia that there's no real evidence this law changed anything. Another example is the UK, after the 1987 mass shooting in an elementary school in Scotland. Strict gun control policies were enforced afterwards, banning the private ownership of most handguns, banning semi-automatic weapons, and having mandatory registration for shotguns. But when we look at the annual rate of gun deaths in the UK, it's again impossible to say that gun control resulted in a reduction in gun deaths because, like Australia, the numbers don't offer any conclusive evidence. And they're trying the same thing here, with Joe Biden and his administration pushing a return of the so-called assault weapons ban from 1994. According to Biden, this ban worked and it's going to work again. But that's just not true. Between 1994 and 2004, when the ban expired, mass shootings still occurred and assault weapons were still used. And while some people try to claim that this ban led to a reduction in mass shootings, this ignores that mass shootings are still statistically rare, and when we consider factors like the population size of the United States and the number of weapons used. That's not downplaying how horrendously evil they are. It's just a mathematical fact. So like the gun control actions of Australia or the UK, it's difficult to argue conclusively that this ban had any real impact. For example, based on some research, between 1976 and 1994, there were about 18 mass shootings a year. During the ban, 1995 to 2004, there were about 19 a year. Doesn't really seem like a solution to me. And all of this ignores practicality. The market is already flooded with these weapons. This means that someone who wants to obtain any weapon to commit violent crimes will always be able to, while those who want to use such weapons legally will just be left defenseless. Based on some estimates, there are around 20 million AR-style weapons in circulation in the US, making up just 5% of the 393 million or so firearms owned by US civilians. Assuming that the federal government doesn't have a magic wand which can just take every single one of these 20 million plus guns away, this only leaves forced confiscation, good luck with that in somewhere like Texas, or mandatory buyback, which would fail like it did in Australia. The lesson here is that every so-called perfect solution is either far from perfect or just a lie. So throughout the speech, have you noticed anything? So I'm a massive supporter of the Second Amendment. I'm one of the most pro-gun conservatives you're going to find, but I haven't mentioned the Second Amendment once. I'm about to, don't worry, but I waited for a reason. When you're talking with people who want gun control, they don't care about the Second Amendment. And this raises two challenges. One, to prove that their solutions won't solve the problem, and two, to prove that the Second Amendment matters. These aren't mutually exclusive, but you can do one without the other. But after proving that their gun control ideas won't work, I want to end on ultimately the most important point, that responsible gun ownership is good. We cannot forget that the Second Amendment is an amazing thing. Why? Because it acknowledges our God-given right to defend ourselves against tyranny. It's not about hunting or target shooting or collecting. It's about defending yourself, your property, and your family from tyranny. That could be the tyranny of government. Joe Biden recently said that Americans who want to oppose tyranny will have to deal with F-16s. Ignoring that he basically threatened to bomb his own citizens, we should point out that he surrendered Afghanistan to a bunch of medieval barbarians with AK-47s living in caves, so no. But it can also be the tyranny of an individual looking to destroy your fundamental right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The tyranny Democrats unleashed across the country during months of BLM riots. It's also very telling that the same politicians who want to take away your right to defend yourself against tyranny are cheering on themselves for handing the same guns to people in Ukraine. It's the same reason why they don't care about BLM riots, but they cared about January 6th. None of this is really about gun rights. It's all about power. And the more empowered you are, the less you need government. So I've thrown a lot of numbers at you today. I want to end with this one. An estimated 2.5 million crimes are prevented by firearms every year. That's almost 7,000 a day. This includes 400,000 life-threatening violent crimes every year. So, quick math puzzle. If 400,000 lives are legally saved by firearms every year, and way, way less than 400,000 people are murdered with firearms every year, so illegally, what will happen if we stop people from legally owning firearms? I think it's so easy, John Fetterman could get there with a few crayons and a calculator. But they don't want to talk about keeping guns in the hands of good people and getting them out of the hands of bad people, because that's not the goal. The goal is to ban guns and increase government power. If this means leaving people without protection, so be it. They obviously don't care. Just ask the residents of Portland, or San Francisco, or Seattle, or Ferguson, or Minneapolis, or New York, or LA, if you don't believe me. So I'm not going to pretend that this is a simple problem to solve, though. People will always choose the fake promise of safety over real freedom, and so we're always going to be fighting an uphill battle. But there are several things we can do to push in the right direction and address the real problem that is gun violence. Again, just because I acknowledge that gun violence is a problem doesn't mean that I support any of the usual gun control policies you hear people pushing. But it's impossible to look at gun violence we see every year, whether it be on the streets of Chicago or in a Nashville school, and think there's nothing we can do. Again, I'm in favor of doing something, depending on the something. But I want to do things that protect the Second Amendment, protect law-abiding citizens, and defend the innocent. Not things that hand more power to a government that already doesn't care about us. So first, we need to police communities that are most at risk. The Defund the Police movement has been a disgusting failure, and the people who pushed it have blood on their hands. We can protect soft targets from mass shootings by protecting schools like we protect banks, jewelry stores, and airports. We can improve cross-institution communication and knowledge sharing so that when someone is disqualified from buying a gun by one agency, the others actually know about it. We can improve gun safety and training so that more law-abiding citizens are able to carry in public and defend themselves and their neighbors. We can keep violent people in jail. And most importantly, we can focus on the truth, because without the truth, our freedoms don't stand a chance. Thank you so much for listening. I look forward to taking your questions.
Hi, everyone. We're now going to go into a time of Q&A. If you could please line up in the back by Nectaria. And remember to say your name, where you're from, and come up to the mark.
Hi, my name is Ellie Stone, and I'm homeschooled. I was wondering, all the statistics that you were naming off, would you mind saying what those sources were that you got those statistics from, if you know them?
Yeah, it's a bunch of different sources. I'll post them on my social media straight after this. It's like the CDC, there's a bunch of gun violence websites that track a lot of this. It's too many to list, but I'll share them straight after this.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Hope. I'm homeschooled as well. And my question is, you talked about the Second Amendment being our God-given right. Do you think that there are any regulations that should be put on this, such as mental health checks or background checks?
I mean, I think the question I often get is, do you believe in any laws that protect against the misuse of a gun? And so I think there's always going to be a line that we agree to, right? There's always going to be, you don't want someone who, say, has a history of shooting people in the face to continue getting access to guns. So we all agree that there's a line. My problem with things like background checks is that I do not trust the people responsible for imposing those checks. If we had an objective system in which the people cared about the Second Amendment were carrying out those checks, then at least you'd know that they weren't using it to actively undermine the Second Amendment. And so I think in a perfect world, I'm willing to have all of those discussions about red flag laws, background checks, mental health checks. A side note about the mental health issue is that a lot of people will not get mental health treatment if they are worried about having their Second Amendment right taken away. That's valid or invalid, depending on the person. But until we can actually trust institutions, which the last couple of years have shown us that we cannot, there's no institution in American life I think we can trust, then I do not trust them with essentially more power to take away a God-given right.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Benedict Henry. I'm from Pennsylvania. I go to Regina Women's Academy School. My question is, if the Second Amendment is meant to defend against tyranny from the government, how come, as citizens, we're not allowed to have fully automatic guns? Mm-hmm. And what's your thoughts about that?
Yeah, again, it's a limiting principle on everything. I do not support civilians having grenades and rocket launchers and things like that. Because I think the difference for me is, what is the purpose of that gun? And also, how damaging is it based on the level of training you are required to use? So for example, a semi-automatic gun, very, very simple, one trigger pull, one bullet. If you know vaguely what you're doing, you're aiming at one thing, and so it's a very intentional act. I think fully automatic, there is an argument that civilians should be able to own those, but by extension, let's say rocket launchers. What's the point of a rocket launcher? It's not to eliminate a specific threat, it's to blow up a vehicle, blow up a building, things like that. The risk to civilian damage there is much higher. And so I think there's always going to be a limiting principle. I think a lot of people love to say, I want my own F-16, I want my own, you know, nuclear warhead. It's like, okay, that's, one, not really useful. Like, you're going so extreme that no one who is vaguely in the middle is ever going to meet you on that. But I think it's also ignoring the obvious outcomes there, which everything has a limiting principle, everything. And so when you have access to something that is designed to kill people, like people always talk about weapons of war, a gun is designed to kill someone. That is the whole point. And so when you've got something like that, I think it it's important for us to actually place limiting principles on those. That involves more training, for example, based on the weapon. I'd be open to having that discussion. I think I go back and forth on the focus of your question, though, the automatic weapons part, because there's so many things we can do to get around that, too. But I think by extension, you have to acknowledge that there is a line for everyone as to what people should have access to if the goal is to protect yourself against tyranny, because military history has shown you can do a hell of a lot with semi-automatic weapons. The fact that it's automatic isn't exactly a roadblock to you in the city, but taking away rifles, for example, would be. And so I think for me, it's just debating over where that limiting factor is great, as long as we agree that the Second Amendment is important, that we should have access to some guns. In fact, I think we should all have a debate all day long about which guns fall into that category or not. And so I go back and forth on the automatic weapons part, but I don't think we should all have rocket launchers. And some people here will agree, some people here would disagree. I think that's fine, as long as we agree that we should all have access to an ability to fight against tyranny.
Hi, I'm Joseph. I'm homeschooled. And I was wondering what qualifies it as an assault rifle, because a mini 14 is the same caliber as an AR-15, and they're both 223. So 223, it's the same as an AR-15. So why is an AR-15 an assault rifle and a mini 14 isn't?
An assault weapon is assault rifle is a made up term that they use to sound scary. It's an utterly meaningless term that the pro gun control lobby has basically plucked out of thin air because it sounds scary. It sounds militaristic, and so they use that term because it sounds offensive and people are turned off by that. Something like AR-15, they try and do the same kind of thing. Again, any weapon is an assault weapon because a weapon is designed to kill someone. And anyone who pretends otherwise is lying. Like when people hyper-focus on, I don't think you shouldn't be allowed to have a gun to go deer hunting or trap shooting. It's not about that. You can do those things with it, it's a lot of fun, but that's not the purpose of it. The purpose is to eliminate a threat. And so I think it's all about just the left's use of language to push their propaganda narrative. They do it really every part of American life. You'll notice that they change certain words, like the idea, like the word cisgender has come up recently, of whether or not that's a slur. It's an invented term used to acknowledge gender theory. And we start using it, and we've, without meaning to, acknowledged gender theory. And so I think that's why I always try, and I fall over sometimes, but I try and always say so-called assault weapons, because it's not a real term. And so I think, my answer to that would be it's made up. It doesn't mean anything. It means exactly what they want it to mean in the moment.
Hi, my name is Sophia Jamboni. I go to Huntington Beach High School. I really appreciate you coming here today, and I understand the extreme importance of protecting our rights and the fact that we really need the ability to have guns in order to protect ourselves. But I also wonder your opinion, because with the state of the world today, do you think that the current attack on morals in the US with feminism, BLM, gun control, trans issues, and critical race theory is simply a cover-up to distract Americans from the real global issues? For example, the BRICS alliance, the removal of the US dollar from many oil transactions, the horrors occurring in North Korea and the CCP, and Hunter Biden, as well as many other political figures' involvement in Ukraine?
Yes and no. One, I never attribute this kind of conspiratorial mad genius to politicians. I think most politicians are morons. I don't think they're capable of pulling all of these strings like we think they do, right? But that's not to say that there are not overlaps where people take advantage of one narrative over another, push certain stories over another. I think the media is particularly to blame for this. I think a lot of corporations, a lot of very wealthy people, for example, who have more brain cells in their head than the average person in DC. And so I think yes and no. I think people in politics tend to just go with whatever is going to get them the vote in the moment or make them or their cronies the most money. I think there are very few principled people. And so I don't think they're as conspiratorial as people would like to think. But that's not to say that they don't take advantage of something. All politics is trying to stop people looking at you and look at the other person. Or distract them with something else. So I think it's a bit of yes and no, in a dumb way rather than a smart way, I think is how I'd answer that.
Hi, my name is Megan Brode. I'm from Orange County, California. And so a lot of people at my school are really concerned about like gun-related suicides. Mm-hmm. And they cite that like there's a lack of background checks as like the reason for this. And I know that's not true at all. But I was just wondering, how can we maybe convince them that taking guns away will not solve this problem at all?
Well, because I think gun-related suicide, guns are a symptom of gun-related suicide, but they're not necessarily a cause, because suicidation is still a problem, mental health is still a problem. Taking away the method a lot of people use to kill themselves will not make them feel better. And so I think it's a very, it's like a two-sided coin, because one, I think obviously getting guns out of the hands of people who want to harm themselves is something we should do. And that's an era of red flag laws that are important. If you believe someone is a threat to themselves or others, I think there is some room for the state to come in and at least place a very temporary position upon them where they cannot access those guns. I also think there's a lot of room for community and family to try and prevent people from accessing guns. Like if you have guns in your house and you have a child or a family member who's mentally ill, doing the best you can to prevent them from having access to those things is important. But I think to place all of it on guns is a bit of a cop-out, honestly. I think it's obvious there is a humongous mental health issue in the United States that I think is the result of a lot of other issues that we see, like a complete lack of identity, a complete lack of drive. I think a lot of young people being told that they are really held no worth unless they're a part of a certain identity group, which is meaningless in terms of human value. All these identity groups that are some better than others, it's utterly meaningless. Each individual has value. It doesn't matter what flag you wave based on your sexuality. All that stuff is, we're regressing as a country. And so I think a lot of that can cause severe mental health issues, either people embracing that or people feeling rejected by that. I think there's a huge sense of hopelessness that COVID-19 didn't do it, policy around COVID-19 did, of forcing people into their homes and, oh, shock, they're depressed, and they have mental health issues. And so I think I would rather try to address the overarching problem, which is mental health. I'm not gonna say I have solutions to that. And there are small, low-level things we can do regarding guns relating to that. But I think simply using that as an excuse to take people's guns away or background checks, like a lot of people who deal with mental health issues are quite good at hiding in plain sight. But it's something we cannot physically see. That's one of the biggest challenges of mental health is someone can seem fine and they're not. And so, one, are they going through this background check in the first place? Most people have access to guns. Like a lot of young people are not buying guns themselves. Most can't until they're a certain age. It's guns in the home. And then how do you deal with that? I would rather try and focus on the issue of mental health, which kind of kills two birds with one stone. It's just a much harder bird to kill.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nathan Thomas. I'm a homeschooler from Blythe, California. And by the way, I love Morning Wire. It's crazy that you worked on that. But my question is, has there been instances in your life when you've convinced other people of your position on gun control? And if so, what did you do to convince them?
Yeah, I think one thing is just trying to put a realistic and a rational face on the pro-gun issue. I think this is something I experience a lot as like someone British coming from a place where there are no guns, coming to somewhere where there are a lot of guns. It's quite jarring and it's a shock at first. And so I think I understand that almost revulsion a lot of people have to just a gun being out in society. And so I think I can empathize with that. Once you talk to people about the fact that gun owners are responsible, they care about gun safety, and that the idea of the crazy American shooting in the sky screaming is just it's a propaganda image, right? It's nothing but that. And so I think once you can actually speak to people about the experience of having met people who are pro-gun, who are far more knowledgeable about guns than the government will ever be, they're far safer with guns in terms of teaching people and trying to make sure that people understand that it's a weapon, not a toy, things like that. I try and just put, all the times I've been successful with someone who disagrees with me is putting a rational face on it, acknowledging the concerns they have, but then also showing them that the assumptions of their concerns are false. Throwing stats at someone doesn't tend to help because that just makes them feel like they're being bombarded, but disproving the emotional assumptions they've made about everyone who's programmed being evil and wanting to kill children, once they wake up to just how really absurd and wrong that is, they're much more conducive to actually hear pro-gun statements. Things like, what do you do if you live in a rural area and the police aren't there? What do you live in an urban area and the police are not allowed to police in that area? Also funny when you bring up people who are anti-police, but also anti-gun ownership. It's like, okay, well, you don't really care about people, do you? You're giving them no option. And so I think it's trying to approach people with kindness and understanding is the best way to reach anyone on any issue, and I found that with guns as well.
Hi, my name's Josiah. I'm from Fresno, California. I just want to know your thoughts on the ATF creating their own laws, just such as the recent banning of all pistol braces.
Yeah, I mean, I think the ATF, the fact that, you know, the T and the F don't really, I mean, the A and the T, rather, don't really mean anything. It's all about the F. They only care about firearms. I think this is part of the broader attempt by really the Biden administration, but also just the deep state generally, is to leverage power in any way they can. I think the fact that they are bypassing Congress and local laws to try and really limit our Second Amendment right in any way is obviously abhorrent, but completely unsurprising. We see this in every part of American life. The IRS do it all the time. We have various health agencies that do it all the time. All the left care about is power, and so they use every single tool at their disposal to increase their power over us. They do it through culture, they do it through politics. And so for me, it's just another part of that broader problem. Hardly unsurprising given that they are openly going after alcohol, tobacco, and firearms with a huge focus on firearms. So it doesn't really surprise me. I think it also shows how important it is who leads these groups. They're supposed to be somewhat bipartisan. They're not. It's so obviously partisan. And I think Republicans need to be doing a much better job of fighting tooth and nail to stop anyone who is so openly anti-Second Amendment from running any of these agencies, let alone something like the ATF.
Hello, my name is Cannon Bess. I'm from Carlsbad, California. And as a Californian, we have very restrictive gun laws. And my question is, as youth, how do you think we should fight back and try to win our rights back?
Yeah, I think that's going to be a very, very hard thing to do because California is so far gone. So I lived in California for 8 years, and one of the first things I did when I moved to Tennessee was take that really stupid breakdown button off the AR-15, like the dumbest invention in the world. Violence solved, I guess. The problem is you've got so many people around you who actually think things like that work. And once you've got a deep blue state like California that has pockets of such deep red as well, a lot of people don't realize is that, you know, you go outside the cities, California is more Republican than really any other state in a lot of ways. When you have that division, but that level of control on the Democratic side, it's going to be incredibly hard to change that. I think the way to do it is to try and have a youth-led movement of high-level pro-Second Amendment positions of why it matters historically, why it matters for individuals to take responsibility for all areas of their life. I think that's how we move in the direction of improving gun ownership and gun rights in somewhere like California. It's not going to happen, I think, by fighting on the lower level of just fighting, say, the 10 bullet versus 30 bullet magazine. Like, they think these things work. I think we need to fix the overarching problem again, which is the fact that government think they can solve every problem. That's much harder to do. I think it's a generational problem, but I think that's something we failed, and I think the generation above us has failed even more so. And so hopefully younger generations can actually start moving the needle back in terms of taking responsibility for themselves. Because all of this is rooted in responsibility. Like, firearm ownership is about responsibility for you and your family and your property and your community. When we hand over that to the government in return for supposed safety, we are not taking responsibility. And I think that's an attitude that has to change. And once that changes, a lot of things will come with that. It's not a helpful answer because I haven't really helped you in any way, but I think that's the only way it's going to change.
Hello, my name is Alyssa Casares. I'm from Palo Verde High School in Las Vegas. My question to you is about school shootings, mm-hmm. and do you believe that the media bringing more light to them is actually making the problem worse?
100%. I don't think the media are to blame for them. I don't want to do what the left does and blame someone who isn't actually responsible for doing so. I think they are entirely responsible for breeding a contagion theory, infamy-seeking frenzy around these situations. I think they are responsible for pushing the false narrative that school shootings are statistically the largest problem in the field of gun violence while actively hiding politically inconvenient stories, like the fact that most mass shootings are not white children being shot in a school or white supremacists shooting non-white victims. Like the fact that they just ignore black-on-black violence and black-on-black mass shootings is terrible. They do not care about the problem. They care about getting the clicks. They care about pushing a political narrative. So I think in that way, I think they are entirely responsible. I think it is down to us as consumers, though, to not feed on that content. There's a reason, especially with the rise of social media, there's a reason a lot of media companies across the political spectrum push certain narratives and push certain stories because they know what people will click on. It's like this submarine story, to go completely off left field. It's the submarine story. I've seen so much about every single individual, you know, what they said. This far, far distant cousin of one person on the submarine went to a Blink-182 concert. Oh, my goodness. But that's the state of our media right now because we've become so dumbed down and stupid. That's the garbage we click on. And so I think it's a double-edged sword. I think the media is responsible, but I also think we as a society are responsible for feeding on garbage. And so both of those need to be fixed because as long as there's a market for garbage, they'll keep producing garbage.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm from Buchanan High School. And my question for you is, what is the percentage of stabbing homicides in comparison to gun homicides? And what part of the population is most likely to be murdered by stabbing?
Oh, I don't know that. I can certainly look that up. I don't have those to hand. And I don't want to speculate. But I think one important thing is that I think stabbings, for example, in the UK have exploded. There's no real gun violence to speak of, but knife rates in places like London have exploded. There is always a need for violence for some people. There's always a need to express violence. And so I think an obsession with the tool of violence does not solve the problem of violence. And so I'll certainly after this try and look those things up. I don't want to pull numbers out of my hat because that would make me no better than Democrats. But I think in terms of knife violence, that's certainly a problem in any country. It's also harder because you can go to literally any store and buy a knife. And how do we solve that? Do we ban knives? No. And so it's a proof that there is a level of violence that we can never avoid. It's just about trying to address that in ways that respect our rights at the same time.
This is going to be our last question.
Hi, my name is Reagan Kleiber, and I'm from San Diego. You talked about it being a God-given right to protect ourselves against tyranny with guns, but guns also being a weapon meant to kill others. Mm-hmm. However, God speaks out multiple times against murder in his word. How do you reconcile these claims of yours given that God values all human life and speaks out against murder?
Murder is not the same as killing. So killing someone in self-defense, like the Old Testament specifically talks about your right to, say, use violence and to kill someone to defend someone else. That's perfectly in line with Judeo-Christian principles. Otherwise, if we just had no violence whatsoever, we would be surrounded by violence. Like, there has to be a position where we are willing to act to defend values that we hold dear to ourselves, to our society, for whatever reason we hold them. And so I think you can be against murder, but in favor of specific types of killing. I think there is a distinction there. So for example, if a child was walking along, someone was trying to kill that child, are you supposed to just let that happen because God thinks all life is sacred? It's like, well, who is valued more, the innocent child or the person who has already stepped over that line with the intent to harm someone? There is, obviously everyone has value, but some people give up that right to value when they are setting out to try and harm someone else. And so I think other people have a responsibility to act. And so I think you can certainly believe that. Yeah. Thank you. So I think just to finish that off real quick, so you do have a responsibility to act, but there is a definite difference between killing and murder, and I think the left take advantage of that as much as they physically can. Thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure to speak with you all.